strength is gone.
You are faithful forever. My heart is so filled with joy.
Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God. Welcome, 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 welcome everyone to another month of June 2021. Another exciting, incredible, wonderful session that is coming today again from the Networks Business Club. Thank you for joining us at this experience session. We're really grateful. Once again, my name is Olusegun Oyetunji, and I welcome you on behalf of the Networks Business Club, and I'm of the RCCG City of David. Welcome to everyone. We're indeed glad that you are here today. This is a day we have been waiting for. We are excited. We are ready. We are set. Even though the rains are pouring in, we know people are also pouring in. So I'll use this opportunity to say thank you for joining us this early, for those that have come in this early. And use this opportunity to also tell your friends, your families, your loved ones, your colleagues, your business partners, your close ones, to come in and join. Some of them might have forgotten today, so you can share this on your WhatsApp groups, share the information on your Facebook, you know, profile, Instagram, and everywhere, and invite people to come and join. Thank you once again. Thank you very much. Okay, today is a special event. It's a special day. Everything special is going to happen today, and I can already feel this, because of course we already have our guests in the house, but also not just that, what we are going to be hearing today is something that I can assure you will definitely blow our minds. The experience that we're going to be listening to today, and the person we're going to be speaking with, is somebody that we've known for a while, and we trust God that every day, everything the guest speaker says will definitely minister to us. But as we're doing this, I would like to just say thank you. If you can hear me very well, and you can hear me loud and clear, just let me know. Just put loud and clear, or just say yes in the comment section. Let's also see our participants. We can see several people here who join us regularly. Oh, wow. We can see Adenike Onikute, Ayodele Fashakin. Welcome to everyone. Oh, good morning. Dolak Popopola. Thank you, Enyayo Mohammed. Thank you very much for joining. Okay, Musumola Koka. A lot of people already here. Wow, wonderful. Pastor Regina Jemide, Remy Banjo. So we are seeing our people as well, and the numbers are growing. Before we get into today's event, there's something very important we'll do, and I'll call on someone special as well to do that important part. But as we're doing this, before we do this, we'd like to know, where are you reaching out to us from? We would like to know where you're calling, joining us from. But before we do this, let's take something important as well. So that will be the next thing we'll be able to do. So at this point, I'm going to call on Mrs. Obiagali Ogbeche, who is a founding member of the Networks Business Club, to please come up and take the opening prayer for us. Over to you, Mrs. Ogbeche. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. It's nice to be here again today, another month of the sessions. Let us pray. Father, I want to say a big thank you to you for our lives. It's not our rights, it's a privilege from you. And we want to say thank you. Thank you for the rains. Thank you for our businesses that are thriving, even in the midst of all that is going on. Father, I pray, O Lord God, that this session will supersede our expectations. Thank you for what you do through this forum. Thank you so much, O Lord God, for encouraging our businesses and opening our eyes to places we can diversify into. Lord, we give you all the glory and all the praise. Help our guest speaker for today to minister to so many lives and so many souls. Let people be encouraged to do all sorts, to look into their talents, to find more into their that which you blessed them with. Lord, we are grateful. Thank you for the sixth experience session for this year. It can only be you, O Lord God. Thank you for all the people that have been a blessing to these sessions, O Lord God. May your name alone be glorified. And as we surge ahead, help us not to get tired, O Lord God. Be glorified as we go through this session in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen, amen, amen. Thank you very much, Mrs. Obi. Thank you. We appreciate you sincerely. She's a staunch and strong member of the Networks Business Club, part of the people that are making this happen every single month and other events. And there are so many things that we do in the Networks Business Club. We are just much more than a club. We make impact across different sectors of the economy in Nigeria. We have captains of industry, so many people, so many things that if you're just joining us for the first time today, you'll be glad to know more about us. Okay, I can see Mr. John from Ogba, Lagos State. So let us know where you are joining us from. If you're joining from Lagos, just put Lagos in the comment section. Thank you, Mr. Udo John. We appreciate you. Thank you for coming. Okay, let us know if you're coming from Ibadan. We'd like to have a feel of where our audience, our participants are joining us from. Because, of course, we always have a global audience, and this will be very good so that our guest speaker would also know the kind of people she will be speaking to. Oh, I can see someone from Walsall, UK here, Bolero. Okay, from Surulere in Lagos. That's fantastic. Fantastic, fantastic, fantastic. Different people from Lagos. Lagos is in the building today. Okay, so we thank you. We're sure other people will join us. Don't forget, we are also streaming this live on the YouTube channel. Go to RCCG, City of David, YouTube channel, and our Facebook page as well. So you can also go there, comment there, share there, and would also be able to take more information from there. Oh, Iyatun. Thank you, Iyatun from London. Different people here. Wonderful. So what we are going to do is very simple. I would just like to remind us of some of the ground rules today. Well, not ground rules, some of the housekeeping rules I would like to have today before we proceed with the event. So if you'd like to ask questions, this will be a very interactive session. If you'd like to ask questions, make sure you are ready. Make sure your questions are short and precise. If you want to ask the questions live, please check that your microphone is working well, your background, your lights, you know, everything, because this is a global event. I would like to make sure that the quality of, you know, whatever we do here is good and is also high. So make sure that you are set and you are prepared. And make sure your questions are direct and is relevant to what the guest speaker will be talking about or anything that you think will be at least useful for this event. Once you can do that, we'll give you the opportunity to ask your questions live. And for those that don't want to come on live, maybe you're camera shy for whatever reason, you can also chat in the chat section here. Just go in the chat section and type your questions there as well. Some of my colleagues will be able to pick this up so that we can also read out your questions and get them answered. And for those of us watching on YouTube as well, please note that we're also with you. So please put in your questions, even though you can't ask live, but please type your questions. Let us see your questions and on Facebook as well, or any comment at all. So we'll be able to have this. Taiwo from Lagos. Taiwo Adeniji, nice to see you. Lola from Lagos. Lagos is leading here today. So we have a lot of people from Lagos. So thank you. While we expect others to join us as well, because this is a business meeting, we will definitely move on. And we'll move fast with this because, like we said, other people will join us. And this is a recorded event as well. So for those that will not be able to join immediately, they can always go back and watch this. So thank you, everyone. And if you're excited and you're ready, please type excited in the comment section. So say excited. Say I'm excited. Type excited, excited, excited. Let me feel the energy and let me feel your presence. Let us feel that you are with us. So if you're excited and indeed happy to be with us, type excited in the comment section and let us see this. Oh, thank you, Pastor Regina. Thank you. Adinike says she's excited with her emojis. Wonderful. Taiwo is excited. That's the spirit. And I'll tell you why you need to be excited as well, because you are going to be blown away today. I can assure you that. Okay, so we're going to move on swiftly now. To our next item on our agenda. And for those that do not know much about the Business Club, you're going to hear much about this club, this wonderful club that is bringing you this event today. And I'm going to call on none other than Mrs. Folake Adama to please come and give us our chairman's opening remarks. So I'm going to hand over to Mrs. Folake Adama. Over to you, Ma. Thank you for the chairman's opening remarks. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Shego. Great job every month. Business Networks has really, really been having an impact. On behalf of our chairman, Mr. Enesebi, MFR, I would like to welcome every one of us to this great platform. This platform is a vision from our own very dear Pastor ID. His vision, its support, you know, has been carrying this forward. And we want to say thank you and appreciate and acknowledge you, sir. And we also would like to appreciate Pastor Shiju, who is a visionary, who's been a wonderful leader to the women since we'll be speaking through women today. She's been leading us in a very powerful prayer platform. Convener of Arise Women, the Handmaidens over 20-something years, the Congress. We also would like to acknowledge you today, Ma. A great leader, a cheerleader for women, inspiring them to do great things. I also want to acknowledge Funke Bokno, who is a sister. I mean, you know, her family, her mom was a very good aunt of mine. Funke is a leading force in the industry of events. She's even taken it further. She's created a niche. And we are welcoming you today, and we're looking forward to the great things you're going to do for us. Now, Business Networks, I'm going to also say, you know, a very big thank you to our leader, the person who's heading Business Next Door, Pastor Emeka Undu. I can't go without acknowledging you, sir. Thank you for all you've been doing over the years and all the team. Well done. Great job. Business Networks is a Christian business club. And we've been doing a lot. We have this experience session every month. That's been powerful. We've had Mr. Shini Adetu who has spoken. We've had Mr. Mutu Simonu who has spoken. We've had Ms. Shola David Bora who has spoken to us and inspired us through their live experiences. We've had so many people. And then we have entrepreneurship training programs. We've got a lot. We've had conferences every year on the economic summit that we always did every year to educate the public on, you know, what to do in the next year and much more. There's so much going, and would really encourage you all to join us. It's a very powerful force. What our major mission is, to be able to make a difference in the marketplace. We believe, you know, this is to equip, to empower, to inspire Christians to go there in the marketplace and make a huge difference. We believe we can take dominion, you know, wherever we are, in competence, in courage, in commitment, you know, through our integrity, our dignity, our authenticity, and people will see, you know, they will see that we are following Christ. We have to be the example. We see it in the Bible with Daniel, you know, who was showing example of wisdom, example of godliness, example of righteousness, and that actually built the trust in the king of that time. Each are not even one, even more than one king. Also Joseph, because he would not sin against God. His major theme and motto was, I will not sin against God. So everything he did, he was doing it as doing it for the Lord. So we are being equipped, you know. If you join us, although as Christians, we're supposed to be doing that naturally, but we're going to be learning much more in this club, you know, and we really encourage you to join us. When we make such difference, you know, unashamedly, you know, standing on the word of God as our principle, as our guide, and leading people, you know, when people see you at the marketplace, when they see you exuberating godliness, righteousness, integrity, dignity in this world of corruption and all, there's no way there will not be a ripple effect that will eventually transform our nation. So we are the examples, we are the role model, And we're encouraging you to join us in Business Circle. I would like to welcome you all and encourage you to join us. Every month we have this experience session. Please do join us and be a member, be a part of the business networks of the city of the, Region 20. Thank you so much. Thank you, Shegun.
Thank you so much, Ma.
Privilege.
Yes, Ma. Thank you so much, Ma. Wow. Can we please appreciate Mrs. Folake Adama? She's a staunch pillar in the Networks Business Club as well. Can we appreciate her, please? Can we appreciate her? Say thank you for that wonderful speech. And she said so many instructive things, and I would want us to go back and listen to her speech one more time. We say thank you to her. We have wonderful women in the Networks Business Club. It's not just a club for men. We have women who are titans in their own right and in their own industry. We collaborate. And that's the beautiful thing about such a platform like this. It's a platform that accommodates all of us, especially for those of us who are in the Christian folk, which is the main thing. So let us be ready and let us be excited. Okay, so if today is your first time of joining us, because I can see some new names here. Yes, all saying thank you. Adebayo Olaya is saying thank you. Minako is saying thank you to Mrs. Folake. So we've seen it. Thank you. So if today is your first time of joining us, can you let us know in the comment section? Just write first time. We'd like to know, because like she mentioned, we've had wonderful guests in the past. And for those of us that have been coming, I'm sure that's one of the reasons why you're coming back. You know that definitely we bring people of no mean repute here. People who are solid, who are captains of industries, not just in Nigeria, but globally. And that's just the thing, because we're in a global environment and it's a global platform as well. So Adenike Onikute, this is your first time. Wonderful. Laura, first time. Chika, first time. Elizabeth Odebiyi, first time. Maureen, first time. So that's wonderful. You need to know more about us. Follow us on all our social media platforms. Networks at Networks Business Club. Just look for us. Easily you find us. Networks Business Club on YouTube, on Facebook, on Twitter, even though Twitter is currently, you know, on hold, but you know, we are still there. Just join us, because like I said, we're a global platform. So just join us and follow us to see more exciting things that we do. Oh, fantastic. Dr. Donna Omesi, nice. Oh, we have a lot of first timers here and the participants are growing. Fantastic. Do not forget to share this. While we are doing this, share this event on your platforms. Let your friends know, because we are moving swiftly into the main event for today. But we'd like you to invite more people to come. It's a rainy Saturday, and yes, people might be rested and all that, but it will be a good time for them to be able to join us and, you know, get great insights, acknowledgement, learn a lot of stuff that will help them move their business and even their personal careers forward as well. So be nice and encourage your friends to come. Okay, fine, fantastic. If you're enjoying yourself, we're grateful. So fantastic. We're going to move on to the next segment now. Now we've already done the first thing that we had to do, which is we've already put this event into the hands of God. And we're not shy to do that because we're Christians. We're a Christian business club where we invite all folks to join us so that when they join us, they see why we do what we do and how we do it and where we get our own success from. Okay, Sami Falabi, thank you for joining us. Olaide Ishijola, wow, a lot of first timers. We acknowledge all of you. Even Jacqueline Akinshon on YouTube. We see you, Jacqueline. On YouTube, we see you as well. So thank you very much for joining. Okay. Now, we're going to move into another part today. And I will encourage us, make sure you have your questions ready. Not only that, make sure you have your comments ready. Make sure you have your pen, your paper. And if you're using your tabs or your phones, be ready to take down a lot of things. Because you are going to learn a lot today. Not only learn, you're going to connect, which is very important. It's one thing to learn, it's another thing to connect. Make sure you're ready, you're set, your environment is set, and you're ready to connect to what our guest speaker will say today. Okay, at this point in time, we are going to receive another speech from a wonderful person. I say this because in the city of David, she's our mother. She's our own mother in Israel. Now we are going to listen to none other than our own indefatigable, our own mother, our first lady of the RCC City of David, RCCG City of David, the Arise convener, you know, the person who has been a pillar and a support to all of us in all ways that we can never imagine. We're going to listen to the speech of none other than Pastor Dr. Shiju Iluomade. Sit tight and please listen. Thank you.
It's with great pleasure that I welcome you to this webinar put together by the Network Business Club. The theme for this month of June session is thriving in a challenging environment. And our guest speaker at this month's is Funke Bokno, the CEO of Sapphire Events. I'm very pleased and honored to be associated with Funke Bokno. Funke is a dear friend, and apart from being a friend, she's an industrious woman. She's one of the leading women in Nigeria today, building up a business from scratch, and she has done it exceedingly well. There's a part of the Bible, it says, that seest thou a man, diligent in his work, he shall stand before kings and not before mean men. Funke has really been extremely diligent in her work. She has put her all into ensuring the success and everyday growth of Sapphire Events. Yes, right now we're facing a challenging situation. It's not easy to thrive, but the Funke I know is a Christian. And because she's a Christian, I also see that she's planted on a fertile soil. She's not one of those planted on thorny soils. She's planted on the Lord Jesus Christ. And the Lord somehow comes through for her at every point in time. She has faced personal challenges. She has faced business challenges. But she seems to surmount it all. I would also let you into a little secret about Funke, which most people don't know. Funke is very generous. She gives. She's a giver. And whatsoever you sow, you would reap. She reaps in millions, she reaps in bounds, she reaps in favor, she reaps in accolades, because she is a very generous person. For me, as a person, Shiju Liomadi, she has come through for Arise Women on many occasions. She has given to the work of Arise. She has helped us and overseen the Women in Leadership series meetings anytime she's called upon. And to kind of close on my dear friend and sister, Funke, I'd like to say that if you are planted on fertile ground, you will bloom. People will testify to the fact that the ground on which she, Sapphire Industries, our event planners are planted, is a thriving one. They are planted on fertile ground. And the time of adversity calls for a strong, dynamic person. Funke is not only strong, not only dynamic, she is a joy and a delight to watch. Funke, your dancing, your skills at putting to show all that you do at an event, and Funke takes corrections so easily. She looks through every nitty-gritty of our events to make sure that it comes out well. And she also has a school to train people. I'm not going to hold your brief, Funke, but today, as you discuss thriving in a challenging time, I want to say to you, my dear sister, my friend, and a dear friend of Arise, that go girl, keep moving. You're doing good things, and the sky is just but the beginning. God bless you.
Oh, wonderful. Can we appreciate Pastor Shiju's remarks, please? That was a very endearing remark. Can we appreciate her? In the comment section, please appreciate her. Tell her we love her. Tell her we love her. Let us show our love. Pastor Shiju, we love you so much. We thank you for always being with us on all of our events on Networks Business Club. We appreciate you. Thank you so much. Let us appreciate her, please. We love you, Ma. In Facebook, on YouTube, everywhere. Tell her we love her. We need to let her know that we love her all the time and we appreciate her presence and her support on everything. Thank you. 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 Okay. Wonderful. Are we ready? We're getting to, you know, the highlight of today's event. And, you know, it's very instructive that a lot of people are going to be surprised because the person we're bringing in has touched the fabric and soul of our nation, Nigeria, whether we like it or not. whether directly or indirectly. And whether you know her personally or you don't know, probably you would have, you know, something, you'd have come across something that has made her work touch you. Probably you've attended some events. I can see balloons by Boye here. A lot of people from the industry already coming. Beyond the industry, these are people that touch our everyday lives as well. And like Pastor Shiju said, she's a very, very endearing person for those that know her. And those that even know her from afar, they testify. Because, you know, when people talk about people, let the report be good. Now, I don't want to even take your time because I'm just going to quickly read her profile here. If we want to really talk about what she's done and all the things, it will take much on it. But I'll just quickly give us a brief insight into her profile. Well, we expect our guests to also, I mean, our participants to also join us. So more people have joined. We appreciate that and would want more people to join. So go and get your friends, get your popcorn ready, get your tea or whatever you're taking, wherever you're in the place, on the planet, you know, just make sure you are ready and you are set as well. So here we go. 15 years as a foremost event planner has earned Funke Brockner Ubrute a place amongst Nigeria's industry leaders. She is the founder and current chief executive officer of the Zafire Events Group, comprising Zafire Events Limited, the Zafire Training Academy, and Deco by Fortula, a pioneer events planning company in Africa that has for many years continued to set the trend for event architecture and design in Nigeria. Funke's passion for innovation and excellence has built a leading wedding and events brand that has delivered well over 1,500 successful events across the globe and has still remained relevant. Her passion for walking brides through the wedding process led her to publish the Essential Bridal Handbook, a first of its kind wedding resource for the African market. For this reason, she also set up Funke Says, a YouTube series for brides which guides them through their wedding planning process. This avid entrepreneur is also obsessed with sharing industry knowledge and giving others room to bloom. This resulted to the creation of Zafire Training Academy in 2009, which has birthed over 500 events professionals. More avenues to share knowledge was the recently organized Zafire Connect series, which brought together past interns and staff of Zafire Events and alumni of the Zafire Training Academy to collaborate, network, and help them forge ahead in their businesses and careers in the event industry. Also, she went ahead to organize the Event Experience Africa, TEXA, which is an annual conference geared towards equipping an ever-growing audience of event entrepreneurs with the right tools needed to thrive in the industry. The conference is targeted at seasoned event professionals and beginners alike, empowering them to be more and do more at the same time, providing them the opportunity to learn, unlearn, and relearn. The maiden edition was in January 2019 and had over 600 participants from different parts of Africa. As a highly regarded influencer and speaker who seeks to impact lives, she has spoken at various seminars, workshops, and conferences within Africa and globally. Little wonder why she is regarded as one of the top three wedding planners in Africa. I'll repeat that again. Little wonder why she's regarded as one of the top three wedding planners in Africa and was recently appointed a member of the advisory board for the Destination Wedding Planners Congress, DWPC. In 2016, she was also hosted by the King of Dubai for being one of the top 10 event planners on the African continent. Being recognized within and outside Africa for her countless contributions to the Nigerian events industry, Funke was included in the BBC 100 Most Inspirational Women in the World 2016, and this had only two women from Nigeria, and has also been featured in several local and international media platforms, such as Forbes Woman Africa, CNN Inside Africa, among others. She has bagged several entrepreneurship awards, merit awards, awards for outstanding contributions to the events industry, and awards for Wedding Planner of the Year. Funke is a founding member of APWEM, Association of Professional Party Organizers and Events Managers of Nigeria, an associate member of WIMBIS, Women in Management and Business, a member of ILEA, International Live Events Association, and alumnus of Enterprise Development Center of the Pan-African University. Funke holds an LLB degree in law from the University of Lagos and a BL from the Abuja Law School, with which she practiced briefly, an alumni of the Pan-Atlantic University. OM, she reads as much as she loves to write. Please, ladies and gentlemen, guests and participants from all over the world on the Network's Business Club, let us welcome the one and only FBO, as she's fondly called, Mrs. Funke Bruckner-Obruthe. Welcome and over to you, ma. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Oh, my goodness. I am quite overwhelmed just by even listening to, you know, the my profile. I'm thinking, oh, my God, is that me? Thank you so much. Thank you for having me. Thank you for such an honor. I'm just happy. I'm happy that I'm here to be able to share, you know, some knowledge. Listening to Pastor Shiju call me friend and sister, I was shy. I nearly wanted to cry. That's why I put off my video at that time she was talking, because I was really overwhelmed by that. You know, thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you for all that. Thank you for everybody for being here with me today. So I'm not going to waste our time. I'm just going to go straight into what we're talking about today, because I know that a lot of people are also dealing with so many issues, and they just even want to learn how to even navigate out of where they are, you know. And for me, I'm still learning to navigate out of it. But it's always important whenever I want to share to bring things into perspective, to share context, to share my journey, my story, and how I've been able to transcend from every single part of a challenging environment, which we're still in now. But how am I still staying relevant or standing or thriving? Because sometimes you want to give up. And there are many times that I want to give up. I've always wanted to give up, but I keep on pushing and persevering. So thank you. And I just pray that even as we speak or as I talk, you know, someone gets something, you know, from here today. So thank you. So I want to just first of all start, you know, just from the very beginning. From the very beginning of my life. My life has been a life of just even, I would say, sometimes stumbling on on my passion. You know, a lot of people will tell you that when they were growing up, they knew what they wanted to be, or they knew their purpose in life. I didn't know my purpose. I just knew that I wanted to make people happy. I love to just go into a room and everybody's happy. That's why I love dancing. That's why I love laughing. That's why I love, you know, just smiling. It comes naturally to me. I want everybody to be excited when they get into a room, just because I know that it's not easy. Life is tough, and we all need some joy in our lives once in a while. So I studied law at the University of Lagos. Of course, you know, when you're younger, your parents want you to study a professional course. In my generation, you know, then it was like you needed to do a professional course. Oh, it had to be engineering, medicine, law, you know, things like that. And I studied law. But as time went on, I realized when I was in University of Lagos that law wasn't for me. I said, and I knew, because guess what? I felt lawyers, let me tell you why, I felt lawyers were a bit stiff. I felt that law was too, you know, too, sometimes I felt too intellectual. And I said, no, this is not me. I need to bust out in a room. So I said, you know what, I'll do this law for my parents, but when I'm done, I'll do something else. So while I was in Unilag, of course, I was, you know, always helping my friends organize things, just helping them. My friend had a business, I would help her promote it, you know, things like that. And then after that, I got into law school. And while I was in law school in Abuja, I realized that I loved helping my friends more. So my friends were getting married, you know, and I would be like, oh, you know what, let me help you plan your wedding. Let me help you coordinate it, you know, let me help you. And that's how I started. But at that time, when I was in law school, I did not really know that it was event planning. My friends, a few of them have said to me, Funke, you told us that you wanted to be a wedding planner in law school. I didn't remember. Isn't it funny? But maybe they said I used to say it. I said, eh. They said, yes, you were always saying that you want to be a wedding planner. I said, are you serious? But all I knew was I wanted to just take the stress off my friends. So the first thing that I want even in this is, for anybody that is going through any challenge or trying to thrive, you first of all have to remember your why. Why are you doing what you do? Why are you in business? Why are you doing what you're doing? Fine, it's okay to say, I want to make money. That's why I'm doing it. It's okay to say, I want to bring joy to people's lives. That's why I'm doing it. It's okay for you to say, I just want people to have a great experience with my product. That's why you're doing it. It's okay to say, I want to add value to the society. That's why I'm doing it. But you need to know the reason why. Because when the challenges come, when the storms hit you, the reason why you are doing what you do is what will keep you. People talk about having a vision. Yes, having a vision is good because a vision keeps you focused. People talk about your mission. But the third one I have to tell you is your why. Because your vision could be, oh, I want to be the best event planner in Africa or globally. That is your vision. But to me, that is not your why. Your why is, I want to create and give joy to people. I want to also get the burden off people. So that's one of the ways one of the things I started with. I wanted to ensure that people were not stressed when they were planning their event. I wanted to make sure that they enjoyed their event. There was a lot of joy in their event. That was why I actually started event planning, because people were stressed. When people are planning their wedding, they're always stressed. And I was like, why are people stressed like this? You know, like, what's going on? You know, so along the way, that was the main reason I, you know, went into wedding planning. I started out as a wedding planner, but now we're a full-grown event planning company that plans any type of event. So very critical to understand that you must know your why. Well, your why will keep you. Your why will keep you, and your why will sustain you. Someone says they can't hear. Is it me? Can everybody hear me?
Yes, we can hear you, Ma.
Thank you. Okay, just saw somebody saying you can't hear me. Okay. So your why is what will keep you. Your why will sustain you. Very, very critical. Now, you know, as I've spoken now, people are thinking, but you just started now. You were in an environment that was easy. I want to tell you that it was not easy. Let me tell you why. First of all, nobody wanted to hire a wedding planner. Nobody wanted to hire an event planner. Everybody thought, who is it? In fact, then I was a tiny girl. And, you know, like, people would just be like, who is this girl? Who is this young girl? Who is this? What do you want? What can you do? You know, this was 19 years ago when I started. So first of all, the major challenges that, or major, I would say, tidbit I would give anybody is that you may want to start a business, or you are currently in a business that seems like as if, oh, nobody even wants to be a part of it, or nobody understands it. You need to keep pushing. You need to keep pushing. You know, I said your why. You need to keep pushing, because guess what? Sometimes people don't know what they need. People don't know. People didn't know that they needed event planners or wedding planners when I started 19 years ago. Now everybody's an event planner. Everybody wants to be a wedding planner. But when I started, people didn't know they needed the service. So sometimes you have to give people what they don't know they need. And you have to create it. So it's almost like you create an environment that does not exist. You are creating it, and then you are pushing forward. My first challenge was people did not even want to pay for the service. People thought, what is it? But I gave them value. People saw value. I didn't give up. So when I planned my first event, I gave it my all. Hard work. I worked hard, and I was determined to deliver an excellent event. Of course, it wasn't perfect. But I guess what? I recovered from whatever mistake it was, and I pushed forward to make it better. Something that Pastor Shiju said, and, you know, I honestly, she said that I'm somebody that takes corrections. Or even if, see, in any business you do, you will make mistakes. There will be challenges. You will fail. You will fail multiple times. You will be rejected multiple times. But guess what? It builds a spirit of resilience in you. A spirit of never giving up. There are times that I've wanted to give up. I've cried on my bed. There are times that I've thought to myself that, oh, I thought I did well. Then somebody calls me and says, Funke, you didn't do so well at that last event. You guys didn't do this, you didn't do that. And I think, oh my goodness. Okay, what can I do better? What should I do? Okay, next time, this is what I'll do. This is how we'll correct it. And I sit down with my team. So very, very important. You need to ensure that even when you do make mistakes, you find a way to rectify it. Because guess what? Mistakes will come. You will make mistakes. Nobody's perfect. Nobody's perfect. Only our Lord that is perfect, right? So you're going to make mistakes, but you must put processes in place, machinery in place that will enable you to correct whatever mistakes you've made in your line of business. Very critical. Those are the things that will teach you, that will hold you, and those are the things that will help you, because nobody's above mistakes. And I learned that every day. For a long time in my life, I was afraid of making a mistake. If I remember one time, some years ago, I made a really big mistake on an event. Well, and a mistake that maybe I would say wasn't really, really my fault or our fault in our company. But it was a mistake nonetheless, right? And guess what? When that happened, I went to dig my head in the sand. I went to hide. And I said, I'm not doing events again. I'm not. People should leave me alone. And I remember then my late pastor, Pastor Escott, called me and said, Funke, you made a mistake. So what? Are you the first person? Please. And then he used to call me international event planner. Then I used to laugh, me that I'm still local. Then they had given me Isho. You know, Isho means at the embassy, you know, in the American and British embassy. Yes, you know, this was maybe when I was 20 something. You know, when you're younger, you used to get your visas. Then when they changed the policy, they were not giving me visas. And I was like, me, international event planner. Me that I don't even have visa to go to London or America. Why am I international? But guess what? The words that people speak over you, the positive words that people speak over your life, are the words that, even the words that you have gotten from your prayer closet, you need to stay on those words and you need to believe those words. You need to believe it. I remember when I wanted to, I didn't used to speak. You know, I started this and I told one of my my colleagues then who used to work with me, and I said, I want to start speaking globally. I want to speak. I want to be able to share my knowledge. I want to be able to. And she said, because I would see people speaking, right? And I would be like, oh, why can't I be? Why? I have so much knowledge to share. Why can't I talk? And I said to her that one day I'm going to be speaking. So the power of our words. The power of our words are critical. The power of the words. So your words, what you say about yourself and what you know about yourself, what God has given you, what God has said about you, the good things that God has said about you, you must hold on to it. And you know, remember I talked about your why from the beginning. But as you go, you must have, your vision must be clear for yourself and your business. Because your vision, your mission, your why, your core values, your strategies is what will keep you. There are many times in our business that at times I've thought, what is going on? What is happening? Even when you are going in the wrong direction, you know, all you need to do is just change direction. Change direction. You know, people will say you are not a tree. You are not a tree. You can change direction now. A tree is stagnant. But you are moving. You are walking. All you need to do is turn around. Just turn around and change strategies. So one of the things that has also helped me thrive is that change in strategy. And this doesn't just come from me. So let me say, when you surround yourself with a good team, a lot of times, as leaders, we don't surround ourselves with a good team. We surround ourselves with yes men. We surround ourselves with people that cannot tell us when we're doing something wrong. You need to build more leaders. As a leader, you build more leaders. As a leader, you build and empower people. I'm very big on that. So I'm always ensuring that my team, they're empowered, they're built. And guess what? As you build, your team will also make mistakes. They will make mistakes because nobody is perfect. Remember we said it? You allow them Allow them make mistakes. Allow them grow. Because it's from those mistakes that you will be able to correct. And it's from those mistakes that they will grow as you have grown. Because experience is what has made you grow. Experience is what has made you be where you are today. So very critical that you do not discount or you do not forget your team. It is not I, it is we. So as much as possible, there's that constant we. Look for the strengths and weaknesses of each of your team members. Look for your strength and build your strength. Build on your strength. And when you are weak, look for people that will cover up for you there. Everybody has a strength. My strength, one of my biggest strengths is I get into a room and want to make everybody happy. It's one of my strengths. I want to make sure that people are happy. I want to make sure that even when we're planning an event, everybody is satisfied. It's a strength for me. But guess one of my weaknesses? I'm impatient. So I realize that because of I'm impatient, just because of the excellent spirit I have of wanting everything to go well, and people are just not getting it right, I get very impatient. So I realize I need people to help me. You know, so it's very important that you recognize your strengths and your weaknesses, and you recognize the strengths and the weaknesses of your team. Very critical. Very, very critical. I've said, remember your why. Another thing is I want to talk about is focus. Focus. Laser focus. You know, when someone is running, you know, when you have the people doing the 100 meter dash, right? And they're running, you know, they look right. Well, maybe Usain Bolt, sometimes he looks, because he's so good, he looks. But most of the time, they don't look left and right. Even when you do look left and right, you're not looking, you're trying to just make sure that, you know, internet connection. Okay. You don't look left and right. You're focused. You're laser focused because you're looking at the finish line. You are looking at that tape that you are going to cut at the end of the day. You must stay focused. You must stay focused. Stay focused on why you're doing what you do. Stay focused. Stay focused. Focus is very hard. It's very, very hard because there are many things that want to just pull you down. There are many things. There are many things. But you just have to try. You just have to try. You just have to try. Staying focused, very, very critical. Very, very critical. So that is one thing. Now, another thing, you know, I said stay focused, da-di-da-di-da. But another thing is never be afraid to ask for help. Never be afraid to ask for help. A lot of people are afraid to ask for help. Me, I'm never afraid. Me, I will call, I have my advisors. I have my coaches. I have my pastors. I am never afraid of. I will call my friends. I say, this is the challenge I'm going through. This is my trouble. Ha, help me. Ah, what do I do? What should I do? Where should I go? And they will say, okay, Funke, maybe we should do this. I think we should do this. I think we should do that. I am never afraid to ask for help. But guess what? This also brings me to the part of where the power of relationships. A lot of us will say, oh, I don't need this person. I don't need that person. I don't break bridges. I don't burn bridges. I try my best to make sure that I harness my relationships. I look for what? Look, let me tell you. A lot of us will say we want mentors. A lot of us will say, oh, we want people to be our mentees. Or we want mentors. But what are we ready to give? What are we ready to sacrifice? What are we ready to do? What are we ready to do? What are we ready to do? The power of relationships. And when I'm saying relationships, I'm not talking about relationships, husband and wife. I'm not talking about relationship. I'm talking about business, friends. You know, when you network, you meet people, you never know where this may get you to. You never know what you'll need tomorrow. A lot of us, you know, there's, you know, this generation, there's the younger generation, there's a cancel culture. I beg, we cancel them. What do they know? What are they talking about? What are they saying? You know? But guess what? It's not every time you cancel. It's not every time you cancel. It's not every time you cancel. It's not every time you just, you know, boom. It's not every time. You just have to be patient. You have to be tolerant. But make sure that you continue to build your relationships. Where you can help, you help. Where you can give, you give. Where you can support, you support. Where you can listen, you listen. Because guess what? It's what you deposit that you can draw on. A lot of times, we've not even done anything. We will not just want somebody to drop everything for us. For what? Who are you? What have you done? That somebody should just drop everything. What have you done? What have you given? A lot of people think that, oh, all I have to do is give. I don't have money. Money. Have you given your time? What have you done? Have you given your time? Have you contributed? When they called you to come and help with something, how did you help? You can't give money. Not everybody can give money. But sometimes you can give your time. Sometimes you can support. Sometimes all somebody needs is a word of encouragement. All somebody needs is just help, guidance. And even if you are the one that needs guidance, but you must have deposited in a bank for you to be able to draw on it. So please, very important, the power of relationships. I hope someone is noting this down, because these are the things that will help you thrive in a challenging environment, because it's very challenging. We're in a challenging environment. So, you know, I talked a bit. Now, let me take you through another journey in my life. So, we're doing events. I had first move. You know, we have first move advantage. I started 19 years ago. We're one of the first. Everybody wants an event planner. Amazing. Di-di-di-di-da. And then along the way, things start changing. Conversations start happening. Then you see that your industry is changing. One thing that is very important for anyone is you must learn to study your environment. You know, when they talked about the sons of Issachar, they said that they understood the times and the seasons. You must understand the times and the seasons of your environment. We're in a very challenging time at the moment. Forex is going on. The prices of everything is high. We came out of COVID. We thought that coming out of COVID, we're going to be relaxing. We came out of COVID, and guess what? We got into a place where the economy is just like, hey, God, what's going on? But guess what? That spirit of resilience that you have. I want to clean my teeth. There's lipstick on my teeth. Hello? Sorry.
We can hear you, ma.
Okay, sorry. That spirit of resilience, that spirit of, how will I say, tenacity, that spirit of never giving up, that spirit, we all have to dig deep. We have to dig deep. You know, for those, maybe some people that don't know. So in 2017, I think it's 2017. Yes, 2017. I lost my dad in 2017 in August. And it was very tough for us, right? But just two children, myself, my mom, my dad, my mom, my sister, and I, just four, you know, in a family. I lost my dad. Then in 2018, I lost my only sibling, my sister, my younger sister. I will not lie to you. I wanted to give up. When my dad died, it wasn't even so bad, because I felt, okay, my dad was 72 or 71. I mean, he's lived his life, he's okay. Then I lost my younger sister. I thought my life was over. I thought, why should I leave? I thought, I can't continue to move. I can't continue to, you know, I didn't go into depression, but maybe I might have nearly gone into depression. Or maybe I might have even wanted to end my life because I just thought, what is the essence of life? If my sister could die, why? What is it? What are we living for? I was angry with God, though. I was very angry. I was angry. But guess what? You know, when the Bible talks about, you see, a lot of times, the Bible is nugget of wisdom. And your faith, because there are many people on this platform, some are even Muslims, some are Christians. Most are Christians, some are Muslims. But your faith is what will draw you. Sometimes you need to push deep into your faith. You need to push and pull. So you know when they said David encouraged himself in the Lord, God knew. He needed to write that statement for us because he wanted us to know that David, who went through so many adversities and so much pain, was able to encourage himself in the Lord. So it is something that we also have to do. I had to make sure that, you know what? Once there's life, there's hope. Once there's a future, once you are not yet dead and you are alive, there's hope. And you can correct, and you can solve, and you can breathe, and you can live. Then there's nothing that is harder than surmounting that challenge. So for me, that was one of my hardest challenges. That was one of my hardest. But I said, you know what? I have so much more to give to the world. I have so much more to give. God has deposited so much on the inside of me. Funke, where are you going? That was my own encouragement too. I was like, where are you going? Where are you going? Okay, you go. Your children, your mother, what happens to them? Do you understand what I mean? So I had to get up. I had to stand up. I had to, you know, like almost like leave. You know when they say leave? So I want to encourage someone that is here that even no matter the challenge you are dealing with, no matter the environment, no matter what this environment, Nigeria is a tough environment at the moment. And it's seeming like it wants to crush us all. But when we are crushed on one side, we are pushed on one side, we have been close to get on one side. But guess what? Once we are alive, once we are here, and we have nuggets in our brain, we can do a lot. We can do a lot. So which brings me to another point. Another point is, when you are seemingly in a situation that seems challenging like it is now. So, you know, I said we were in COVID, right? When COVID hit us, I thought the business would die. I thought this business cannot survive. I thought, what? COVID hit in March, right? We were even planning an event. In fact, when they gave that announcement that they should shut down event centers, our event was the event, one of the events. We had an event on Saturday. They gave the announcement came on Friday or Thursday. We're already decorating. Big event. Spent millions and millions. Clients have spent millions. We had to shut down. So we thought, okay, 1 week, 2 weeks, they will open up now. COVID is not so bad now. It's not really hitting us in Nigeria. Then we're there. March, April, May. No events. Nothing was coming. And you know, you've planned your year. You have your goal, your 2020 goal. You are going to make so, this is your revenue target. And I was looking, I said, which revenue is not entering? So I was afraid. See, it's okay to be anxious. It's okay to be afraid. I want to tell somebody today, it's okay to be afraid. Very okay. Don't let anybody tell you why. It's okay to be afraid. You can't be afraid. You can't be anxious. But when my fear and anxiety passed, I said, okay, what are we going to do to survive? So you know there's surviving and then there's thriving. So the first thought was, what are we going to do to survive? Before I even thought of how to thrive. Survival. But I got from a place of survival to a place of thriving. And I'll tell you, one of the things that helped me was, I realized that, first of all, I'm not in this alone. You have to know that you are not the only person going through what you're going through. people have gone through it. Yes, I know COVID was new, but businesses, let me tell you what I took from it. I took from it that businesses stopped, but in life, people have had challenges where businesses stopped. So COVID hit, right? Businesses stopped. So I thought, people have gone through this. What did they do? What can I do? So we thought, we sat down, and I sat down with my team. That's why I said the power of the team, the power of an internal team first before you think of your external. So managing people, managing clients, managing my team, managing family, all those things were there. But I said, what are we going to do? And then from there, we started thinking of, you know, how to re-strategize. What can we do? What do people want? We started thinking of virtual events, more virtual events. We started doing virtual events. We partnered with an amazing tech team that helped us deliver some excellent events. In fact, we became the queen and kings of virtual, I would say, funerals, birthdays. In my life, I never thought, I didn't like technology. I thought, for what? But when they say something made you do it, I was forced to embrace technology. I only liked my social media. So sometimes when you are faced with, you're pushed, you're faced with challenges, you need to dig deep within yourself to find ways that you can thrive from that challenge. What can you do? So you think, you not to think, put your thinking cap. I know that it's one of the hardest times to think. It's one of the, but you know what? You need to go into a place. That's why I said, I sat down. I thought, I had ideas. I came and sat with my team. We thought of different things. That's why we started our virtual training. Our online, we've always been training. We've always had a training school. They had told us to go virtual years ago. I said, for what? People like the physical experience. People want to, you know, they want to feel you. They want to. When COVID came, they didn't teach us. We went online, boom. And it was so successful. It was so successful. Boom. In fact, one of the revenue we made from the one of our online training, we were able to pay salary for 2 months. We didn't touch our savings. We didn't touch. We paid salary. I said, hey, there's money in this space. I did not leave it though. I said, what can we do better? So the key thing is, what I'm bringing out here is that things are deep within. You know, then during COVID, people will say, go and diversify. Sometimes people thought that diversification meant going to diversify into places you've never experienced, things you've never done, things you don't know. That was what we thought. People thought. Go and diversify into those places. Go and diversify into those places. You know, so we just thought, we realized that diversification for us was diversifying in the same space we're in. We had always done it. We've always had our training school. We have our decor arm. We've always had it. But even in those businesses we had, we still went deep into ensuring that we diversified in a different way. The decor team started doing interior, home interiors. Office interiors, because a lot of people were working from home. People wanted their offices, their homes to be beautiful. So we diversified in there. Our event arm diversified. We started planning intimate events. In my life, I never thought. So this also brings me to humility, being humble. Never, never be too proud to get things done. If somebody needs me to kneel down for Bola, or somebody needs me to speak to someone, I am never too proud to want to learn. I'm never too proud to want to say sorry. I'm never too proud to want to say I made a mistake. I'm never too proud to ask for knowledge. I'm never too proud to ask for help. Never be too proud. Never stay humble. Stay humble. A lot of people, they just start and the next thing, boom, everybody just wants to, you know, be proud. Stay humble. Humility goes a long way. Humility goes a long way. Where I am today is by the grace of God. In fact, as far as I'm concerned, I'm not even where I want to be. I struggle with doubts, and which we all do. Oh, this imposter syndrome. Am I really this person? Am I really doing this great? But you want to be better than where you are now. So you compete with yourself. Constantly compete with yourself. Where you are now is just the beginning. It's a little bit of where you are going. Where you are now. So don't think I have arrived. Oh, I've made some money. Oh, I've arrived. Why is it? What's money? What? Oh, they know me. Oh, I've arrived. No. Stay humble. Stay humble. I remember when I went to speak in a conference in Thailand, and I was speaking, I was representing Africa, and I thought, they know me? The next thing, I was invited to speak in another place. Then we got an award, you know, internationally recognized award in the events industry. You know, I think it was about 3 years ago. And I thought, how did they find us? How was it? Guess what? Because what we did was we were perfecting our craft locally to attract a global audience, but we were perfecting it here. So one of the things I also want to say is when you're talking about thriving, you must perfect your craft. You must hone your craft. You must own your craft, perfect your craft. Be excellent at what you do. Strive to be excellent. Perfect it. A lot of times people want to grow, boom, fast, without perfecting where they are now. Perfect it. Own it. The value you're giving. Make sure the product is so good. You know, a lot of people will talk about, and I give Coca-Cola as an example. I'm a Coca-Cola addict. I drink Coke a lot. It's not very good, but I drink Coke. But Coke is very nice and sweet. Coke has been like that since I've known Coca-Cola. But do you know what Coke does? Coke does not sit down and say that everybody drinks Coke. They know us. We are not going to promote ourselves. Coca-Cola advertises like crazy. Why was Coca-Cola? Do you understand what I mean? So Coca-Cola should be proud and say, we are Coke. Everybody drinks Coke. Because if it was only me that was drinking Coke, Coca-Cola would be selling them. But guess Coca-Cola is not sitting down. So who are we? Who are we? Who am I? So this is for anyone that is listening, that whatever it is that you are doing, whatever your product is, Coca-Cola's product is good. The Coke is sweet. And it has been like that since I was young, since I was 3 years old. I can remember that Coke has been the same way. They've perfected their product. You must perfect your product. You must perfect it so well and continue to improve on your knowledge. You must continue to learn. So even as you want to thrive in this challenging environment, you must expand your knowledge. Me, I can travel to the end of the earth to go and get knowledge. What I don't know, I will ask. The one I want to learn, I will go and study. I'm always reading. I'm always checking. I say, hey, please, how can I? And I'm never too proud to learn. Most of the people that work with me are younger than me. I have just one or two people that are my mates in my office. Most everybody is young. I go and sit down and say, come and tell me, how do I do it? Hey, what should I do? Hey, how should it be? Hey, tell me. Hey, I ask who. I come down to their level. So in order to stay thriving in this environment, you must seek knowledge. Once you have perfected your craft, you have, you know, you're perfecting your value, you must seek knowledge. You must want to learn. As we are here on this platform today, we are seeking knowledge. But knowledge seeking without execution, without action. For me, this is one of my greatest weaknesses. I get knowledge, but sometimes to execute, fear stops me. But I've been executing. There was only a time my excuse was, my sister died. So there's nobody to help me. So I'm not executing this and this. But guess what? An idea is just an idea until it's executed. Everybody, and guess what? God gives all of us almost the same ideas. If as God has given you this and said, go and do this, he has told 100 other people. But the one that executes is the main thing. So God gives all of us ideas, because some people always feel like it's only them that God speaks to. God gives a lot of people ideas. It is the execution that is the cocoa. It's the execution. Very critical. Very critical. So I said, I've talked about stay humble, I've talked about focus, I've talked about relationships, I've talked about, you know, not being afraid, that you will be afraid, there'll be anxiety, but you need to push. I've talked about knowing your why, I've talked about asking for help. I think I've talked about, change strategy if you have to. So if you're in an environment or your business, and maybe your direction. So let me give you an example, and I'll tell you about myself. So I run an event planning company, right? I've been doing this for 19 years. I started when I was probably like 24 or 25. I'm going to be 45, right? Okay. Now, the generation that I started with 19 years ago were my mates. So they were the ones getting married. So it was easy. Oh, Bola is getting married. Let me plan your wedding. So I knew they were getting married. It was very easy. But as time went on, they started becoming older. And then the generation became younger. So the generation became younger. And they were feeling like, I'm an auntie. I'm a mama. How do I stay relevant? One way to thrive is to stay relevant. How do you stay relevant? How do you transcend 19 years of a business and still be relevant for each generation? You always have to think. You always have to look at your goals and your strategies. Your strategies will change. So that's what the reason why I'm saying is that, because your strategy could be, let me give you one big example. So for us at Zafire, we were very big on, I just want to take the stress off your client. I didn't care about anything else. I just want to take the stress. Let me just help you take the stress off you. Then along the way, it was now becoming about experiences. People wanted an experience. They wanted the bride to fly from the roof. They wanted the cake, a bird to bring the cake. They wanted that when you open the cage, the doves come out. I said, this is what they want. I said, okay, not a problem. How do you stay relevant for each generation without losing your core values? Without losing what makes you who you are? You must stay unique to yourself, to your brand, because you must not lose that. So what is the uniqueness about you? What is different about you? You must hold on to that. We're very big on energy in our company. We're very big on joy, on fun. We're very big on excellence. We're big on customer service. We don't play with those things. And we're big on professionalism. So those are our core values. We're not going to lose those core values. But we're going to still tweak and stay relevant to the generation. So what are we going to do? We're going to perfect our customer service so well that you must find us. We'll perfect our joy, energy so well you must look for us. But we will also give you what is trending. Because you must also, what is trending? Chuck it in somehow. It's like an iPhone. iPhone will come today. They're giving us iPhone 10, iPhone X Max. Then it becomes iPhone 11. Then it becomes iPhone 12. What is iPhone just doing? It's the same phone, no? They'll just come change camera. They'll just come change this. They'll just come. But you are still striving to get an iPhone. Do you understand? So very important that you build yourself, you build your brand, you build your business so well. You build it so well that people are looking for you, for that value you bring. That is why they look for you. So you must build it so well. It is easier to be tossed left and right. There was a time, even in our business, we too, we thought, everybody is doing this. Let's go. Okay, this is what they want. We are the same people that came back and said, let's stay true to ourselves. Will those that are our clients and our customers will come? They will come. They will come. Sometimes you will not, maybe in the month of June, you will not see them. Maybe in the month of January, you do not see them. But it does not mean that you will not stay real. It does not mean that you will not keep on perfecting. Those that are your clients will come and they will pay for what they need to pay for. They will pay for it. So you need, those are some of the things that has helped me to thrive, to stay relevant, to thrive in this challenging environment. You know, when you wake up and you have to leave the house at 4 a.m., traffic, you have to leave the house. So I started looking for ways to help even my team. So now, even because of COVID, we don't work five times a week. We now work just three times a week physically. Then Monday and Friday, we do virtual. That Monday and Friday, they work. But sometimes I know that they are just chilling. It's okay. Lagos is stressful. Nigeria, stressful. But as long as they're delivering, as long as they're doing their work. So let me tell you another thing that I wanted to say as well is that you also need to be self-aware of yourself. That is you as a person. You need to know what makes you tick. What are your strengths? What are your weaknesses? You as an individual. I had to learn those things too. I had to learn it. You understand? So very, very critical. I'm sorry, let me just quickly check my last note. Okay, my last note. So yes, so my last note is, you need to build a spirit of resilience. You need to build a spirit of tolerance. And you need to build a spirit of excellence. Very critical in order to thrive. And much more than anything, never lose your faith. Never lose your faith. Never, never, never lose your faith. Never lose your faith. Yes, you can ask questions. You can be frustrated, but never lose your faith. Hold on to your faith, because that is the only hope we have, we all have. And we're all together. That's the only thing I just wanted to let everybody know, that we're all together. So do what makes you happy. Do what brings you joy. Me, I love dancing. See, do you know, let me even tell you another one. Do you know that some people have come to me and said, you dance too much. What is wrong with you? You don't know you're old. Always dancing. When I was younger, when people used to say that to me, I used to be sad. I'll be like, it's true. Maybe I'm too old, or maybe I'm dancing. Some people said to me that maybe when you marry, you'll stop dancing. Some people say, maybe when you have children, it's your energy, you still stop. Some people say, maybe when you become 40, I'm going to be 45 tomorrow, I'm still dancing. Guess what? Because I found out that was me. I love it. I love dancing. I love the joy it brings to people. Do you know people that call me? I met a lady, a Cameroonian. And she said to me, she called me and sent me a message. She's a Cameroonian. I said, those are your videos. It brings me joy. How do you do it? Sometimes when I'm sad, I go to your videos and I feel happy. Why will I stop? When if it's only one person that I bring joy to, I'm not going to stop. If it's only one person that I bring joy to, I ain't stopping. Because I like dancing. It's therapeutic for me. And I know what it does for people. And that is me. That's my personality. I'm not going to change it. Which is why I said, know your strengths, know your weaknesses. Some people, not everybody will like you. And not everybody is for you. Not everybody will like you. Not everybody's going to like your, the way you speak or the way you act or the way you do. Not everybody like you. So don't worry about that. Just be you. So Thank you so much. I think that. I hope I've not shot my time.
No, you have not. You have not. Thank you so much. Everybody has just been glued and been listening. Thank you so much, Ma. Thank you so much, FBO. It's like as if you should just continue and not stop. But we thank God. Everybody, can we all say thank you to FBO in the chat section? A lot of people have been chatting, saying thank you. They've been listening. Some have just been quiet. In fact, Sumba Photography on YouTube, she was just saying, you know, exclaiming and all that. So people are saying so many things. People from London, from all over. We have Mrs. Funola Fora too, also there, a first timer. Different people that are coming in and asking questions. So thank you so much. Wow, 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 wow. Yes, ma. So what we are going to do very briefly is we'll just go into the Q&A section. Then, of course, we'll curate this. So we still have more time with you. And we'll go. And we know that even this whole event here today cannot be enough. But we say thank you so much, ma. Wow. Okay, so what I'm going to do is very simple. Everybody get ready. Make sure you are ready to ask your questions. Type in the chat section on YouTube, on Facebook. Let us have your questions as well. The team will be ready to pick this up. If you want to ask a live question, you have to raise your hands up. You can use the raising of hands up button in the on the Zoom section. So those on Zoom, yes, please make sure your environment is okay. Your microphone, your speaker, everything. And make sure your questions are direct and short. Thank you. But I'll go first here. And I'll just like to bring you back a bit. You know, you've shared your wonderful story, and like we call this is the experience session. So we like to, you know, delve much into the personality of the person that is speaking to us. So, you know, growing up, you mentioned daddy, of course, you mentioned your sister, mommy, and all that. So you come from the famous Buckner family that we all know. And I just want to ask, is there something probably in the growing up, because your sister too, we love her too, you know, was also in the media space. Daddy too was in that space, and you're also in the creative. So it's like as if there's a connecting thread. Is this something that you guys were eating at home or drinking, or what really brought out that creative process and made everybody go into that particular, you know, connecting area of that creative industry, so to speak?
I think that to be truthful, I'm not sure that there was anything like in particular that happened. But I know, for example, my mom was as a businesswoman, she had always been into business. Ever since I knew my mom, you know, she was always doing one business or the other. And then my dad, of course, my dad worked, you know, for some time, 9 to 5, but he went for his passion later, which was music, you know, because he had always been into music. So I just think that that environment maybe just pushed us or propelled us without them, you know, just, you know, like pushing us forward that way. So I think that was it. And because we were also in an environment, my dad was very knowledgeable. My dad was very intelligent. My dad knew anything about anything and everything. And he would share and talk and let us speak and let us express ourselves. You know, we had an environment where we could express ourselves. The only time they didn't allow me to express myself when I said I wanted to, you know, not study law. And they put their foot down and said, lie, you must study law. You know, but that was the only time, you know, because they felt... it's a professional course, you must do this. So, but I think that it's just a general thing in our family, because even my cousin sings, my uncles were musicians, they sing, they play the keyboard, they play pianos. My late uncle, Captain Wale, you know, was, you know, used to play keyboard, Uncle Richard, everybody. So I think maybe it's in the DNA, maybe a bit of the family, but sometimes something can be your DNA, but if you don't nurture it or grow up or push it, you may never see it grow. So yeah, I think you might have played a little bit. Part of it.
Okay, fantastic. Thank you. Because I know this is a question a lot of people, you know, ask it. Even Balloons by Boye also said, is it in your DNA? Because for those that have interacted with you clearly, it's not what you just read. Those that know you and have seen you in action, probably at work, they'll know, okay, there's a grace upon this woman to do this beyond that. And we're not taking that lightly as well, because we're on the platform where we recognize that the spiritual is also very important and, you know, and how this works. So, having said that, you went to study law, this law, yeah. And people are looking at the legal background. Is there anything, because, you know, there are people, probably there are younger people that will be watching this and looking to this, that, okay, fine. Maybe they want to be an event planner. Maybe some, you know, universities in Nigeria are not yet offering professional, you know, courses like that in that environment. Maybe it's not something they can really readily study yet, because industry, I still believe, is still growing and you're helping to shape this professionally. What can you advise younger people? How do they, you know, go about saying that whatever the course I study in university can still help me? Or how did law help you in any way, if I can put that as well?
Thank you for that question. So law for me, right, helped in the sense that now, you know, as a lawyer, you analyze. Law makes you analyze, you ask questions. Law also, you know, helps you with documentation. You learn that you must document. So law has helped me a bit in that area. And, you know, also even in the area of reading, you know, I didn't like reading, but law, you must read and read and read. You know, but I think it helped me to be able to read. So law has helped me. I won't say that anything that anybody does, you know, is wasted. I think that there's a purpose for everything. So when somebody, I mean, people that are doctors or people that are something else, you know. So I think that maybe parents, I would first of all say that for parents now, they know that the young people can do that can build them into what they need to be. So it doesn't necessarily be being a doctor, being a lawyer. There are many professions that are now professions that can, you know, bring them fulfillment and bring money. That's number one. So parents need to open up their minds a little bit more. But secondly, whatever background that anybody studies, so anybody that is here now, because even in my office, a lot of people are event planners in my office. Not nobody studied event planning. They either studied economics, arts, geography, law, technology, you know, all kinds of courses, and accounting is there. But they are event planners today. So sometimes your background helps you in terms of the knowledge you need. Maybe something, maybe in accounting, there's something that you're going to learn when you want to do what you want to do in the future. It doesn't mean that it's wasted. So that's, I think that's what I wanted to tell anyone that is listening, because a lot of people always feel like, oh my God, my life is over, my life is wasting. You know, sometimes 2 years, 3 years, maybe that's what your parents want. Give it to them. I mean, I have people that have come to work with me and say, my parents, I studied law, but I want to know if event planning is for me, because my parents think I should go into the legal profession. And they come and say, you know what? I'm not going to go legal, but I'll do HR. I have friends that are in the HR space and they're lawyers. Do you understand? So sometimes your background will be a propelling force, but at the same time, it helps you, it guides you for the future, but that is not your future. Do you understand what I'm trying to kind of say? So yes.
It's very clear and fantastic. Yeah. It's very instructive that you said that, you know, because like business people will know, you mentioned something very important about team building, how you organize your team and all that. And you talked about people management and all that. You know, in the industry that you work in, you have different people with different educational backgrounds. So how do you, you know, at Zafire, because it's one thing to say I'm an event planner. It's another thing to know how to run the business of event planning. So there's the talent of it, the, you know how of it, and the business of it. So on the business of it part, you know, how do you do, you know, how do you spot talent to work with you in, because it's a creative thing. How do you know that, okay, even though this person said he's an accountant and all that. So what's your, you know, recruitment style and how do you manage your people? Yeah.
I like that question. So the first thing is we look out for attitude. I'm very big on attitude. I'm very big on, you know, how is someone receptive to changes or mistakes? Your degree for us doesn't matter because we still have to train you. In fact, it's almost like you go through an intensive training session. We have modules of trainings that I've put together over the years, you know, that teaches and trains, you know, people that come in through our organization. But energy is also very important to us. We have people that are calm in our office, which is what strength and weakness I talked about. But you calm doesn't mean you are not strong. You need to be also strong physically for our work because it's very demanding. So when I mean strong, it's not like you need to be built, but you need to just have that tenacity and capacity for that strength. You need to also be someone that is jovial. You know, you can't be unfriendly. You have to be friendly. Our clients, you have to be friendly because our clients, you know, require you to be friendly. Do you understand? So very critical, you know, that you're friendly, you're jovial, you have a good attitude, you want to learn. Because, you know, people sometimes, okay, yes, they're learning, but, you know, they have a bad attitude. You know, have a bad attitude to correction. They have a bad attitude to correction. So we're very big on you know that. So that's how we look for people to recruit. Your, I mean, for me, I think your heart matters more than anything. The heart matters more than anything for us.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, that's instructive because, like we said, you know, building a business is very critical, and the kind of people that you also bring in. Speaking of customers, clients, I know you have so many experiences. In fact, we don't even, if you write a storybook of just experiences with different clients, like you said, it will be a bestseller because people will want to also see what kind of unique experiences you have. And there are so many. Maybe I can just quickly, even briefly ask, you know, you talked about dealing with people because it's a people business.
Oh, yes.
So imagine, I can imagine you're planning a, so maybe the first 5 years, you have to break it because you have multiple experience. So maybe let's look at the first 5 years. We have to compartmentalize this.
I want to note, yes, this is a very important question and I get it. So I want to, but keep on talking. I'm just trying to write it down.
So imagine you're planning a wedding for, okay, I'm not trying to come into ethnicity. Let's just say a Yoruba ethnic wedding. And you've gone to the bride, you've spoken to everybody, but you know there are so many people. We'll think it's just the bride that is the client or the customer, but you have aunties who are also de facto.
Hello,
hello, can you hear me? We have people who are probably aunties of the bride who are also indirect event planners. So many people, friends of the bride, who are also trying to help with the event. So many people that have too many sticks in one. How do you combine to manage all these expectations? I know you've mentioned it, but if you can share one experience that you just thought, oh, well, within the first 5 years, you were able to manage them, and what did you do? Because imagine somebody's getting married now. Then the bride, at the end of the day, you just have to make sure everything is fine. Who do you really please? Is it the mother of the bride? Is it the mother-in-law? Is it the aunties? And how do you manage all of them trying to plan the event with you as well? Thank you.
Okay. Thank you for that question. Sorry, my daughter just walked in. Sorry. Okay.
Yeah.
So, say hello. Come on, say hello.
Yeah, let's say hello to her. Let's say hello to her. And tomorrow is your special day. We are going to talk about that as well. Hello. Nice to meet you. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you for that question. Now, at the beginning, and this is for anybody, right, that is also trying to go into the event space, or even anybody that's trying to manage clients and manage relationships. Because the clients that you build now are the clients that will are there for you in the future. And let me tell you, I got this nuggets very early when I was younger. So what am I saying? I planned a wedding for a family, right? And now I've maybe done the father's birthday. I've done a funeral in the family. I've done a wedding in the family. I've done multiple weddings. There's a family, I've done 4 weddings for them. I did 4 weddings. I did a birthday. I did their mommy's birthday. I did their daddy's birthday. I did their daddy's funeral, unfortunately, you know, things like that. But how do you ensure that you also, you maintain the relationships? Now, you asked a question about these families. I learned the art of diplomacy very early in event planning.
Interesting.
I learned it. I realized, I learned, at the beginning, I did not know. But I started realizing that there are many stakeholders in an event. And as an event planner, you must understand every stakeholder at every time. We make the mistake of just thinking that we are only dealing with one stakeholder. There are many stakeholders. So sometimes the bride is telling you something, you're listening. You're listening. Maybe in your mind, you may think that may not work, but you are not. Let me give you an example. I told the bride one day, she asked me about my opinion about her cake. And I thought the cake was not nice. And I said, oh, why should you do this kind of cake? I think you should do something else. And she said to me, it is my wedding. It's not your wedding. So I would do the cake I want to do. Oh my God. I said, oh Lord. I felt very embarrassed. But guess what? I took a lesson from that. That's what, you know, when I said mistakes for you to learn. The lesson there was, next time I want to say it, I will say it in another way. So I'm not going to say, why should you use this cake? I'll just say, oh, should we look at other options? Are there other options we can look at? Are there ways that we can modify this cake or modernize this cake or change the direction this cake is going? I will not just say, why this cake? So I learned that. So learn that to please every stakeholder, what do you do or what do you compromise? Let me give you another example. A bride of mine, her mom wanted to do a particular invitation card. And she fought her mom for weeks. She didn't talk to her mom because she hated the invitation card. Do you know what I said to her? I called her and I said, my darling, this is just the invitation card. When they see the invitation card, they're going to dismiss it. Nobody's going to think that your wedding is not nice because of the invitation card. Let your mom do what she wants. You are at a standstill because of the invitation card. There are many battles we're going to fight in the future with your mother regarding your wedding. Let's give her invitation. I learned to teach my clients compromise. So I learned that every stakeholder is important. Every stakeholder is critical. What do they want at each time? So for example, the bride, I know what to do. The groom, I know what. The groom's parents, I know what to do. The bride's parents, I know. It is about managing each person, understanding them, studying them. Sometimes I go into a meeting and I just observe. I don't speak. I observe. When I finish, then the next meeting, I now know, this man likes to interject. This one likes to have his way. This one prefers that they bow to him. This one prefers, so I will now know what to do. So I will tell, sometimes I'll say, look, no, don't say anything. When I'm speaking, this one I'm going to tell mommy. Okay, mommy, don't say, let me talk to daddy. Hey, daddy, let me speak to mommy. Hey, bride, let me. So you have to learn how to be diplomatic. You have to learn how to manage the stakeholders. And when you do make a mistake, learn a lesson from it and correct it for your next client. Because you will not get it right every time. I mean, 5, 6 years ago or 7 years ago, when I thought I knew everything about events, I met a client that the stepmother was the stronghold of the family, and I didn't know. Wow. And I was aligning with the bride whose mother was not in the house. And the stepmother decided that she would show us Pepe and dealt with us.
Wow.
That was one of my worst events.
Mm.
But guess what? Let me tell you what I did. Well, from there, I learned that you need to understand each family. So do you understand what I mean? Understand each family. Understand who is important in each family. And let me tell you what also happened from that event. Isn't God wonderful? So when it happened, that event was one of my worst. And I told God I wasn't planning an event again. Now I'm tired. I'm leaving event. But after a while, I came back and said, okay, God, I'm back. I'm not leaving event again. But I told God that I wanted a miracle from that event. He should please help me. And I got 3 jobs from that event that covered up for everything that ever went wrong at this event that happened. Wow. Wow. So I knew that God wanted me to still stay in event planning. Because he answered me for that prayer. But yeah, so that's it. So understand the families, understand every stakeholder, and never, never, never think that you know it all. You know, that's what I would say about managing each family.
Yes, you know, you've said so many key things here. Diplomacy, that first one you talked about, that keyword diplomacy is very, very important. And I'm sure a lot of people might not have thought about that, you know, at some of the things they need to always, because very important diplomacy and stakeholders. You must know the power centers in each place. So many things. I hope we're all taking our notes down and all that, you know. And one of the reasons why I asked that question, because I'm on your website right now and I'm reading testimonials from Zafire Events. Everybody, you can go to zafireevents.com and check the testimonial part. Because it's one thing for her to tell us, another thing for people to say. And I saw that the first place I opened, families were thanking you, not just brides. So that was very instructive to say, the whole family were able to satisfy a lot of people. And for example, let me read one here. It says, Funke, you did an amazing job. You were responsive and patient. This choice of words are very important. And you helped make sure that the event went on seamlessly. Well done. Very well done. We are very, very grateful. The Lijadu family. Now, you know, when a family is thanking you, rarely do you see testimonials that you talk about different people coming together and saying thank you. It was not just somebody. So that's very instructive. Thank very you. Instructive. Yes, ma'am. So if we have people that want to ask your questions, please feel free. So that I won't be the only one here. Feel free, raise your hands. And at this point, we'll be able to take your questions. Okay. While we are doing that, a lot of people are saying thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. So another question I would like to ask while we're doing this, you know, this is Nigeria 2021. you've mentioned a lot of things, especially technology, business, COVID. Thankfully, you mentioned, I'm sure a lot of people were waiting for how you talk about, you know, COVID last year, and you rose up to the occasion. For you, looking at this now, even though you said you didn't embrace technology, now there are people from different parts of the world here now. So this global event and what people are doing for event planners or people who are coming into this space, looking at from the next, your projections and some of the things you're seeing, what do you think 2021 in Nigeria with the economy and all that, that business people in this environment, what do you think they should be thinking of? What key three areas are you going to be advising them to say, you know what, look into this, look into this? I know you've mentioned it, but if you just want to drop three and emphasize more on that.
Okay, so I'm not an expert in this, you know, like, you know, the finance people and all the consultants and all the, you know, the McKinsey's of the world are the ones that will tell you all this. But I definitely do know that technology is number one. The tech space, because it makes everything global without doing so much, exerting so much effort, you know, into that. So I would just say definitely, you know, one has to invest in technology. You know, we started late, but we're definitely investing in that. So technology, very critical. You know, it's one thing. And technology means many things. It's not a lot of people think technology means, it just means that, you know, taking your business from where it is and you looking for how technology would help your business perform better. Do you understand? So, you know, for example, I was one of those people that would say, must be in the office. You know, when they say, Ojilo Rawa, kind of thing, like, why I must see you to talk to you. I must see you. Why must I do video call? I never did video. I don't do video calls. I didn't do FaceTime. I didn't know why, for what? Let's talk face to face. I want to read your emotion. But when COVID hit, we started doing Zoom video. Okay, I didn't need to go to the meeting. I can do the meeting online. Oh, fantastic. So I realized that technology was good for you. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? So technology, you know, it helps, it enhances our businesses. You know, you can actually make money from technology, you know, in terms of even developing products. You know, another thing that I would say that is also very good that helps is, you know, is content creation. Because since most of things are going online, you need to look for a way to be able to create content. Create content, you know, ensure that you can, you know, help other people create their content, you know, things like that. So those are the things, I mean, for me or in the space, even for us in the event space as well, things that can help people, you know, either plan their events better or, you know, help people have a greater experience at their event. Because you can't, physical events will still have to happen. You can't remove that. But definitely technology, content creation, and I don't know what else, but all those two
me. Yeah, they're fine. They're very important. Yes, they're very important. Thank you. Even for us at Networks Business Club, because we hold our events in physical spaces before now. But interestingly, since we started using technology and doing this on Zoom, we've had people from all over the world, as far as Australia, that I see regularly that come here, as far as London, UK, they are always here. And that has been very instructive. So we have somebody online who wants to ask a question. So I'm going to call on Kofuorola Fagbamila to please unmute and ask your question straight to the point. So over to you, Kofuorola Fagbamila, please unmute and ask your questions. Thank you.
Good morning, good morning, Mr. Martin. Good morning, great people are there. My name is Kofuorola Fagbamila. I just want to ask some questions about, I have a plan of starting a business, different kind of businesses. Though my issue is, was once financial issue, though I'm trying to do some sort of like maybe forest, trying to learn pattern drafts, tailoring too, at least just to start getting some money. Then I'm doing one online also as well that will bring in money. Though I have my own plan, but at the same time, no man, like people you say, no man is that high. And I just need an advice on how to grow money in order to assist my business. Because my plan is, my first plan about this first business is for me to rebrand my soap products, sanitizer, the toy, because I can make them, spirit and air freshener, etc.
Okay.
So I just want an advice whereby I can pull financial support on my own. Although I do forex and all my things, and I still want to do.
Okay. All right, I think we've already.
I think I got that. So she's looking for how to get money, right, to grow her business, to be able to help grow her business. Well, is it that there are many ways? There's a lot of all these funding platforms that can give you like maybe loans if you need it. And I think you should also, you know, your all that you have, of course, try and invest it, you know, save it, put it in, employ it in, delayed gratification, very critical. I think something that I didn't really talk about, you know, not wanting, not spending all the what you have now, you know, just delay gratification, delay use getting all that you want now. But there are places that you can access loans for SMEs that can also help you if you want to get funds. So that's what I'll say about that.
Fantastic. And I'll also add to this, Madam Koforola, please follow us on our social media platforms. Go to our YouTube page. You see multiple videos from all our guest speakers, even in the past, from last year, and a lot of them have talked about so many things related to this. So please just stick with us, and we'll definitely try to ensure that we share more information. So thank you. Okay, so, you know, Evio, you said so many things. Evio, you are popular. And when I say you are popular, you are famous. We know this. You might not think so, but you are popular and you are famous. There are so many people that I'm sure, because you deal with a lot of people that deal with a lot of people that deal with a lot of people. How do you handle fame? How do you handle, is that the right word? I know you handle it well, but you know, how do you see? Because some people cannot, they don't, this level of fame, they just don't have it. How do you handle fame?
God. Fame, yeah. Shekwe, I'm famous.
Wow.
Okay. So I think what it is I look at it in two ways. And I think first thing is, my life that you see outside is different from my life inside. Okay. They may be the same. And when I say different inside and outside, I'm not talking about pretending. I'm talking about also, a lot of times when you see people outside, is what you see, is what they post, is what they put up you see. You don't see the struggles, you don't see the pains behind the scenes. So I learned a long time ago, and it was my sister that taught me this. She said, look, people love people online. People love people, you know, they just love that illusion. But let that person online make a mistake, they will come for the person. So don't ever be deceived by the love you receive from a lot of people. Not everybody knows you, and they only know you by what they see online. So be careful about your reputation online. She taught me that. She said, look, you need to make sure that the perception of what is online about you is, you don't have to comment on everything. You don't have to talk about everything. You know, that's what, even me online, I don't come and start saying some things, because sometimes people will just be there talking rubbish online and dragging you. And I'm like, what's all this? Do you understand? So I'm very careful about what I do online. That's number one. Number two, I understand that. Once I'm giving, what I'm delivering impact, once I'm delivering value, that is the most important aspect of it for me. Do you understand? Once I'm delivering value, once I'm delivering impact, and if that is what I'm doing online, because I'm not just online to be playing, or I'm not just out there, it's because I want people to also get impacted by things that I do. It's not just for me. You know, it's like your light is not supposed to be covered up. Your light, you are salt, you are light. So basically what you are doing is to impact somebody else. It's to impact the next generation. It's to impact your friends. It's to impact your family, your lives. But your first point of impact is in your family. Then you can impact the world. So I'm very particular, and I make sure that is happening in my home. And then as I'm even doing it outside. So I try not to let it get to me. That's what, you know, I talked about staying humble.
Yes.
I'm very big on that. That's why a lot of times I'll be laughing when someone comes, oh my God, I want to take a picture with you. Oh my God. I'm like, hey, me? Oh, and it's not false humility. You're not supposed to say false humility. I've been like this since I was in primary school. Since I was in secondary school. I have just been someone that is just, I am open, play with people, hang out. But at the same time, when people come and hang out, want to play with me, we play. And I can play with anybody. If my daughter takes after me, she can play with anyone. Anybody is a friend. Anyone is a friend. No matter where you are from. That is how I am. Nothing is too small. No, nobody is too inconsequential for me to want to be friends with. You know, but guess what? I also want to say this part. What the downside of this is that everybody thinks you are easily accessible. And everybody also thinks that you have money to give everybody.
Yes.
So everybody will be sending you DMs, help me, help me, help me. I may not be the helper. I may not be your helper. Don't be angry. Do you understand? I may not be, I can help some people, but you cannot help everybody. I can only do the little I can. So I always tell people, so some people will just, every day I get messages, please help me, help me, help me, my life. And I'm like, it's not everybody I can help, but I will do my best. Do you understand? So yes. For anybody that is struggling with this, just do your best. Do your best. You can't please everybody, but just do your best. But do not let whatever is happening out there, popularity, fame, whatever it is you think, get to you. It's not easy, oh. It's tough. Sometimes, you know, maybe I've posted something, I'm happy. The next minute, I'm angry. Maybe something has upset me, or I've cried. Do I come and start doing a video to say I'm crying, everybody see me crying? No. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? But guess what? I'm dealing with issues too. So that's why I'm always telling everybody, be kind. Pastor, she just said something one day, and I'll never forget it. She said, marry a kind man. Marry a kind man. And I took that to mean marry a kind person. So man or woman, make sure that there's kindness in people. Make sure that you are also kind. So if you want to marry a kind man, you must first of all be kind.
Oh, yes.
So you must be kind. Being kind and nice are different.
Oh yes, because you can.
Yes, that's yes.
Very important. Very important. Okay, you know, very important that you said this. So there's another question I'd like to ask. I can see you, Chiemay, patient. Just be patient with us. We'll just, you know, call upon you shortly. And you know, this is very important. Be kind and all that. Now, a lot of people, let me go back into your industry and ask you a question about the industry. Now, you're a pioneer. You've been a pioneer in this industry. And I'm not saying this because I know this. For those of us that have known about this years ago, you'll know that there's so many things that you started. And some other people that have come behind are probably repeating, or should I use the word copying, what you have done. Because, you know, so many things, so many industry firsts that you've brought in. How do you deal with, should I say, competition, even though I dare say there's hardly any competition for a few people, but how do you deal with the fact that even when you even train, the people you train are probably coming into your space? I know you have a good heart because you talk about kindness, but there are some business people that we've heard on some places anyway that say, if I train them, they will undercut me, they will take my clients, they will take my customers. How do you now deal with
this? I like this question because it's a real question and it's real. And I must speak from my heart. So the truth about it is, there are times that early stages, at the earlier stages of my business and life, this used to hurt me a lot. And why do I say this? You know, you train people, you send them abroad for training. Abroad, I've sent people abroad and they've left after the training. A few, 1 month, 2 months, some people have said, oh, you know, you spent so much money on someone, you know, in terms of investing and they leave. Mm. But let me tell you what I do, what now helped me along the years. I looked at organizations that were bigger than Zafire. I looked at the banks. People leave banks. People do leave banks. And they've trained them. They've invested in them.
Sometimes 3 months.
They pay them. Exactly. They pay them a lot of money. They give them official car. They give them house. But they still go and go to another bank. They still go and start their own business. Some do, some don't. That is how I looked at it. I said, you know what? If the banks is happening to them, then who am I? That is, it changed my perspective. A lot of things about perspective. So I said, you know what? I'm still going to invest in people. I'm still going to train. I'm still going to teach. But I will play my part. Do you know the part I will play? I will make sure that they understand the vision, they share the vision, and they are invested in the vision. People leave for different reasons. Some people leave because they want to change their career. Some leave because they are tired. Some leave because they don't see their future in the organization. They leave. When you understand why people leave, then you can mitigate it. But guess what? It's not everybody that will stay. But while they are there, you must build, you must train, you must teach, you must develop, and you must invest. And you must let them know that you care, and they must see that you care about them. That's how I've been able to deal with that later on over the years. It was tough at the beginning. Don't forget, I was just a young girl starting a business. I didn't know anything. So sometimes I reacted with emotions. when some of this happened. I'd like, for what? Why would somebody leave after I've given you everything? Why would you leave? What I now understood later, that sometimes people leave for different reasons. And this is what I learned. I learned it. And I looked, as I said, I used the banks as a major, major example. Look at the banks. You see it. People leave. I know I have friends that they were head of communications in a bank. They are now head of something in another bank. Why? Meanwhile, they were loyal to that bank for years, 10 years, and they will leave. So if they can leave, how much more? You that you're just trying to patch yourself. So that's how I learned that, you know. So now I have an open mind, but at the same time, it's painful when somebody leaves. Please don't get me wrong. It's painful because I love the person. Let me tell you why it's also painful. There's love. I mean, we're like a family. So I love the person. Do you get what I mean?
Yes, beyond work.
Oh, you're leaving, but I'm not bitter. That's different. That's different. So it's all about perspective. That's the thing. I learned it. People leave now. In fact, I spoke to a consultant in one of these, I think KPMG or so, and I went and I was crying that day. I said, people are always leaving. Oh, I'm tired. I'm frustrated. What do I do? And day two, they said to me, they said, look, even they have people. So when they recruit, somebody said to me, said, when we recruit, we already know that when we are recruiting people in KPMG or in any of these consulting firms, we know they will leave. So they will recruit 50 people, knowing that maybe 30 will leave or 40 will go. The 10 will now be growing. Maybe out of the 10, another 2 will leave. Another 9 will leave. Maybe there will not be 1 at the end of the day. But guess what? They don't go and recruit 5 at the beginning because they know they will leave. So he said, that is the way your business is. He taught me that model as well when I was frustrated about this happening. You know?
Fantastic.
And that has not stopped me building stars. Before, I used to build superstars. But now I build stars. I don't build superstars.
Interesting. Anybody that works.
Yeah, stars.
Yes. Very instructive, very instructive, very important. Because no wonder you've been able to sustain the business for 19 years in our environment, Nigeria. Because it's not just about knowing about the events. All these things you are dropping are, and that is why we do this event at Networks Business Club. For people to learn these things, because they might see you from outside and assumptions, but they don't know what you have gone through to be able to still sustain the business. Running a business in Nigeria for 10 years or 5 years is no joke. Talk less of running for 19 years successfully is a different thing. Now, Chieme Patience, if you're still there, you can ask your question. Chieme Patience, Chieme Patience, the mic is over to you. Please unmute and ask your question. We'll soon be rounding up. It's almost 12, but a lot of people are still here. Chieme Patience. Okay. While Chieme Patience is getting ready, we'll just ask some other questions as well. Ebio, you said you relax a lot with dancing. This relax that you're talking about, because dancing is part of your event. Let's get I don't know how because, you know, and I must say thank you to, I say you've impacted a lot of people. I say this personally because you've also impacted my family, whether you know it or not, through my wife. She's done some events that you also gave her opportunity to do some stuff with her. So I would like to personally say thank you for that. And a lot of other people as well. Yes. You see, that's the thing. The nature of what you do, you never really know how you touch people. And being kind is very important. And we have to say this. Okay. Okay, let's talk about our poem now. Because you mentioned, I saw this in your bio. And we've done some training for them before and some couple of things. Now, you're trying to help the industry. How do we deal with, because you're not just a player in the industry, you're a leader in this industry. So we can see that their efforts are trying to sanitize, because anybody can just wake up and say they're event planners without maybe something to show that they have been certified, or not necessarily, you know, just at least to show that they've gone through the proper training and tenets. What efforts do you think the industry can still do better so that we don't have quacks or charlatans that will just come out and say, because I know how to handle this and that, project management, they just think it's the same thing as event management only. So what efforts do you think is happening in the industry to make sure that it is more professional?
Yes. So thank you very much for that. So what in APWEM, I'm also a member of ALIER, is another event association.
Yes.
The key thing is, you know, I've been in the industry for a long time, and it's important that the industry has a high standard. And because the entry barrier to the industry is very low, So anybody can come in. So what the associations are doing, you know, or what we're trying to do is to try and set standards for the industry. And it's going to take, I mean, it will take a while. It's not something that is going to happen now. But it's important because that's the overall vision. And it takes a lot of sacrifice. Sometimes I'm tired. I will say I'm not doing it again. I'm walking away. Or sometimes I have to just come back and say, no, with this industry must be a professional industry. The way you have the ICANN, the chartered accountants, you have the chartered arbitrators, you have the chartered market, the marketers. You want to make sure that the event industry is that type of, is recognized and respected.
Mm-hmm.
And the only way it can be recognized and respected is if the standards are correct, if the standards are good. And the only way that can happen is, of course, by education, by associations, by you know, like just giving back. So for me, it's about giving back. It's about giving back because I don't want to leave an industry after 40, 50 years, right? And then the industry has gone to shambles because some people that had the opportunity to be able to build and help the industry to be professional didn't do it. So that's actually why that association, my friend Lara started up when we joined her, and now there's so many professional people there running it and doing so well. And then there's Alia as well. So that's the reason. So I'm very particular about that. Yes. So thank you for that question.
Very important.
You know, and it's a good one. Yes.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay. It's almost 12, so we'll soon start rounding up. Because of your time, you know, you're also a busy person and all that, but we like to take more questions. So Olanike Motunrayo, please unmute yourself and ask your question. Olanike Motunrayo, thank you. Olanike Motunrayo, please ask your question.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, hello.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Go ahead.
Okay, my question is, I want to ask, as I know she's married. Thank you so much. You have really revived so many things in me from that message. So my question is, as a married woman, how have you been able to, you know, balance the equation, especially we know we African marriages, how it is, how have you been able to satisfy the family, sorry for that noise, that's my child. How have you been able to satisfy your husband, the children, without affecting your own work? How have you been able to balance that? Because as a woman, I understand there's this much on the side of the woman that needs to be done.
Of course.
And that your husband is not feeling, oh, she's putting much into her work, she's not giving much attention. How have you been able to balance that, man?
Claire.
Thank you for that question. I love it, but I really wish you didn't ask me, because they always ask women these questions every time. They don't ask the men. But, you know, it's okay. So now the thing is this. From the beginning, and for anybody, and I will say this, and I'm being real, you have to understand your spouse. You have to understand each other. You have to understand and you have to communicate. It's about understanding. It's about understanding. I'm very big on that, you know. And no home is the same. No home is the same. If I give you the formula of my house, it will not work for your house. Because me, I know what I'm doing. Do you understand? But what it is about understanding, is about compromise, is about balance, and it's about sacrifice. So let me tell you what I mean by sacrifice. Sometimes I have to wake up earlier. Maybe I have to take my, there was a time I remember I was traveling and I came back from a trip and my children had a play in school or they had something to do in school. I landed that day. I did my trip in such a way that I came into Nigeria. I could have gone from that country to where I was going to the other country, but I came into Nigeria, quickly went to the play, quickly went back home, had my bath and went to the airport for my other flight the same day. I was tired. But I had to do it because they remember these things when you're not there. My husband had traveled. That's why he didn't go, because else my husband would have gone. I wouldn't have forced myself. So it's about sacrifice, about compromise, understanding your spouse. It's also about delegation. And it's also about understanding that you cannot carry all the balls at the same time. There'll be times that you'd have to carry some balls. So for example, there are times that your business, you have to sacrifice something. So for example, if I have to be somewhere that maybe involves my children or, you know, or my husband, I don't need to tell my client. I'm not going to go and tell my client, ma, please, I'm so sorry, ma. My children's school, they say I should come to school. I'm coming to school. They say I should, when your client says, oh, can I have a meeting at so-so time? Oh, I'm so sorry, I have a previous engagement on that day. You don't need to go into stories of what the engagement is. It's only you that understands what it is. But you, it's in your calendar that you make time for that. So it's about sacrifice. Sacrifice for sometimes the sacrifice of your business. Sometimes it's sacrifice in your family. Because sometimes to get what you want, you need to be able to. So I know people that work late hours. You work late hours maybe till 12 o'clock or 1 a.m. or 2 a.m. But you still need to wake up at 5 a.m. to do family devotion. Nobody's going to understand that you slept at 2 a.m. You must do the family devotion at 5 or 6. Do you understand? Or in the morning, sometimes, like me now, sometimes I just want to sleep in the morning. Nobody should come and wake me up. But the children are going to go to school. Even if you have help, you've delegated, you still want to see them, you still want to pray with them. You see, at 5 a.m., 5:30, things like that. Meanwhile, you have worked till 1 a.m. or 2 a.m. Sacrifice. The same thing with my husband. It's understanding your spouse. Understanding. I'm very diplomatic. I taught you the diplomacy, Abby. There's also something called wisdom. As women, you must learn the art of wisdom. Wisdom. People will be saying, oh, roots, Bokoku, or they'll be talking. Let us go and apply the wisdom of Solomon. The wisdom of Solomon. Solomon knew he was not going to kill that child now. My people, he knew. Abby, was he going to kill this? It was not. But he knew the real mother will cry. He knew. That is wisdom. That wisdom of Solomon, we must learn it as women. So as women, we must learn wisdom. We must learn diplomacy, sacrifice, balance. And understand that not every time you will get it all. You will not be able to get it all right all the time. Don't beat yourself up. Cry if you want to sometimes. Be frustrated sometimes. But don't say that you're a bad mother or you're a bad wife. Because you drop the ball sometimes. Do you understand what I mean? And don't let anybody guilt you, but understanding your spouse is critical. There are some things I cannot speak because this is a public platform and it's going online on YouTube everywhere. I cannot say some things, but just understanding your spouse is the most important thing. The first lesson I must tell you, understand your spouse. Then sacrifice, wisdom, balance. The day you can hang out with the family, spend time, do things. Me now, when I don't have an event, I make sure every Sunday I say we must hang out, we must go for lunch. If I don't have an event that Sunday, why? Because I want to spend time with my family. I want to spend time with my children. During the week is busy, we are rushing, but Sundays and Saturdays you can hang out, go for lunch, look for ways that will make things work. You have to be the one to look for ways to make it work. Every home is different. And there's no formula for every, there's no one formula. In fact, there's a lady that I also listened to, PepsiCo, the PepsiCo lady, the MD of PepsiCo at that time. She said that,
Indira Noe.
Our children, is a PA that will be telling her the birthday, when she needs to send a card, when they call her in class, when a teacher is calling, she'll be the one, her PA will answer. She will go and sort it out. But she picks up the calls. She answers it. But she's so busy, she has to have a schedule. So you must create a schedule. Me, sometimes what I do is that in order to also make sure that my children, you know, can go, when they want to hang out, I'll tell their friends, come and hang out in our house. I will organize play dates. I'll say, okay, come and hang out in the house. I'll be in the house with them. We will play. Because maybe I'm not, at least, instead of them going to hang out with their friends, when, you know, I'm at home, they should come and hang out in the house. So they will hang out in the house. We will play, we will laugh, we will run, we will play games. I become a little child with them. And the same thing, even with my husband. So very critical. Understand your spouse, wisdom, balance, sacrifice, boom. And don't beat yourself up when you make mistakes.
Fantastic. Fantastic. Whoa. Well done. Thank you so much, Ma. The time is 12:07, interestingly. And we've done 2 hours. But it doesn't look like as if we've done 2 hours. I could sit there all day and continue to gist with you. But unfortunately, that's not possible. So thank you so much for all this. So what we'll do is we'll start rounding up now. And as we're rounding up, there are some questions we normally ask our guests too. Of course, because we're talking to people who have not just are just starting in life, but people who have achieved, whether we believe it or not. Okay, so we can't hear you though. I think you're saying something. Okay, good. So before I go into those questions, Chiemi Patience, you raised your hand again. If you're here, we'd like to take the last live question. Chiemi Patience, are you ready to ask your question now? If yes, please go ahead. Chiemi Patience. Okay, I think we've tried. So whatever questions we still have, we can ask them. We can just share it. We will find a way to make sure that we can continue them later on. Chiemi Patience, we'll be able to get this. Ask your questions. Let us just appreciate our guest. Let us appreciate her. It's already 12:07. Let us appreciate her. Ma, I would like to ask you one more question, though, if you do not mind. Can I go ahead?
Okay. Yes, please.
All right, then. So let's just talk about your legacy. I know it's still early in the day, but I'm sure because you're a successful person, you always plan these things. Oh, we have someone wants. Okay, Mrs. Folake Adama, please quickly ask your question, Ma, before I go ahead. Mrs. Folake Adama, please ask your question. Thank you. And on mute, Mrs. Folake Adama.
Yes, I actually sent a question for you to ask earlier. One or two people were asking me, if you starting your business 19 years ago into maybe 18 years ago, 17 years ago, the hurdles you would have faced and the obstacles and the failures, and mistakes, as you said, could you please re-explain how you, kind of climbed over them, how you were able to overcome them, what attitude you had, or how were you able to, scale through to become so successful? Thank you.
Hello, Ebio, we can't hear you. Can you hear us? Okay.
Thank you for that. Sorry, you can see that I've changed my position. I'm going for a meeting, so I'm just trying to now gather myself to start going. No, but it's fine. I'll quickly answer the question. So, but basically, I like that. So, the challenges from the beginning, I think that as I was talking, I tried to speak about some challenges I faced at some point and then later. But I'll just quickly point them out again. So, the first thing, of course, when I started, the first challenge was getting people to accept that they needed our services. So getting them to accept and pay for the service, because it was something that was new and foreign. People did not have any event planner. They didn't know event planning. They didn't know anything. So how were they going to even, want to pay, for this service? So getting them to pay. So how they were able to pay, or how we overcame that particular challenge, was getting them to see value. So we gave value, and I made sure that I was excellent in what I was doing. So giving value was one of the ways that we were able to overcome that challenge. The other challenge, if you picked it from what I said, was staffing. No, people leaving, just that lack of people staying. And how we were able to overcome that was by building the right structure. So we built structure, processes, structure, processes, standard operating procedures, of the business. So everybody knew where they were in the organogram. Everybody knew their career path. Of course, along the way, people will still say, oh, it's not clear. So constant training, constant teaching, constant ensuring that you are developing your team. So those were some of the major two challenges that we had at the beginning, So it was getting people to pay for the service and the challenge of staffing. Your team, people that work with you, staying, because it was new. Who knew what event planning was at that time? Everybody was like, what's event planning? So even people would laugh and say, we don't need an event planner. I mean, go away, this little girl. So those were the two major challenges that we faced at that time. And they are still major. The challenge that anybody wants to start a business, they vary. Someone that wants to go into the event space now, the challenge that they'll be facing now is the market is saturated. So what are you bringing to the table that is different? That is the challenge that they will be facing now. So for someone that wants to come into the event space. For someone that also wants to come into the space, if they want to deal with staffing, they already know that they need structure. By joining a business network like this, you already know that you need structure, you need process. You'd already put all that in place. So every challenge, at every level of business, there are different challenges. And for different businesses, there are different challenges. I hope that answered that question.
Yes, it has. You did. Thank you so much, FBO. We love you so much. We need to let you go. We'll just want to say thank you for everything. Dear ladies and gentlemen, we need to let our guest speaker go for our next event. Still share your love. Tomorrow is her birthday, incidentally. We didn't want you to, we wanted to sing for you to say happy birthday. Happy birthday in advance. Everybody, please wish FBO, FBO. Go to our Instagram page, Funke Bokno, look for it. Wish her happy birthday in advance and all that. We love you and we say thank you. If you have any final words for us, just anything you want to say, like Dario or Okoya said that you can be the future governor of Lagos.
So final words. Okay, so maybe final words that I would just say is that, I mean, we've talked about thriving, we've talked about, you know, being in a challenging environment. I just want to encourage everyone to say that you're not in this alone, and that, you know, there are people around to help. Not everybody may be able to help you. Do you understand? Not everybody. When I say not everybody, so for example, now somebody can come to me after this class and say, oh, help me. I may not have the time. You need to just make sure that you look for people that can help you and you surround yourself with people. Very important. Also, secondly, I would say laser focus. Focus, focus, focus. You may have challenges along the way. You can change your strategies, but stay focused. Don't lose your why. Don't never lose the reason why you're doing something. Diversify in your field. You know, so for example, now we have a training school, we have a decor company, we have a rental company. Apart from that, then of course I have my book that I've written, which is me personally, that I've written, and you know, a few other things. So I have a book, and we have a training school that I train. The training school trains. We just finished our last batch of training. As amazing, you know, people from Tanzania, virtual. Physical and virtual. People from Tanzania were there. You know, I was like, oh my God, Tanzania, you know. And then, you know, I Cote d'Ivoire and even, you know, all over Nigeria. So very important to stay focused and never, never, never give up. Don't give up. Don't give up. Don't, you can, if you want to give up, you can give up in one aspect, but don't give up in every aspect. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? Because sometimes maybe it's not working. Change direction, change strategy. But never forget your why. So that's all I just want to say. Thank you so much for having me. I am so grateful. Thank you very much.
Thank you, FBO. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. All right. Then let us release you so you can go and we'll just round up here. Thank you and have a wonderful birthday in advance. We love you. Bye-bye. Everybody from all over the world, let us wish FBO a happy birthday. Go to her page. Look out for her book, The Essential Bridal Handbook. We didn't talk about it much, but go to our Instagram page and just go there. FBO, we can release you, ma. No problem. We'll just continue with ourselves. Thank you and have a wonderful day. Yes, ma. Okay, so please let us show her love. Let us do this. Let us show her love. Thank you so much. And thank you to all our participants from all over the world. You have been far too kind. We are really, really grateful. This video is available. The recording is available. Thank you, Margaret Njokadesuwa. We see you were very active, participating a lot. Thank you, Funlola Fora. We thank you, Abiodun Olatunji. We thank you, Sumbo Photography. We thank you all. Everybody has been fantastic. This has been a wonderful event. I'm sure that 19 years is no joke for somebody to have started, sustained, and still thrive, because her business is thriving despite all the challenges. That's the most important. And in our environment in Nigeria for 19 years, the grace of God has really, because FBO is also a prayerful person. She sows into the kingdom. She does a lot of stuff for the kingdom. So you know that these are principles that you must not forget. Thank you all. We just want to say thank you once again. At this point, do not forget, you can follow us on all our social media platforms at Networks Business Club. Look for us at Networks Business Club. Check out for, you know, the emails we'll send again. We'll also be able to share more information. Just check on all our platforms. Go to RCCG City of David as well on YouTube, on Facebook, and Networks Business Club on YouTube and Facebook, and our website too, net-works.biz. All right. At this point, we're just going to close now. I'm going to call on Pastor Mrs. Stacy Ilega to help us take the closing prayer. If she's here, Pastor Mrs. Stacy Ilega, she'll help us take the closing prayer.
Yeah, so we just want to say thank God for, thank the Lord for this moment. I just want everyone to begin to appreciate God on behalf of Funke. It has been a wonderful session, and it's only by the grace of God that she has done all that she's done. 19 years of God's faithfulness and 45 years of her life, the Lord has been faithful. So I just want us to appreciate the Lord for her life while we're wishing her a happy birthday. Every single day of those years, she has slept and woken up. That's the greatest miracle. Only the living can praise the Lord. Only the living can run the business. So let's just thank God for her life. And Father, we just want to say thank you on behalf of Funke. Thank you for establishing her. Thank you for her family. Thank you for her business. She talked about pushing and persevering. Let us pray that, I mean, she came in with laughter and energy, and that she sustained till the very end, you know. So it is not pretense. She's not just talking. She does what she says. So let's thank the Lord and pray that the Lord will refill her and water her, because she has given. That takes a lot of energy. She's exerted a lot of energy. Let's pray for the Lord to guide her. She talked about change, changing direction, but she needs guidance, okay? She needs to trust in the Lord and not to lean on her own understanding. So pray for her sincerely from your heart, that the Lord will guide her and the Lord will direct her and then constantly renew and transform her in Jesus' name. And then let us pray. She said she doesn't burn, she doesn't break bridges, you know? And the enemy heard that and is always coming to destroy. Let's pray that our bridges will stay strong, our relationships will be strengthened in the name of Jesus. And as you have prayed for her, I just want to take a moment to also pray for yourself. Ask God for wisdom to execute what you've learned. You know, she talked about wisdom. It's not just learning. You have to execute your knowledge. So, Father, we thank you for this opportunity, and we pray, Lord, that we also will take knowledge from here and we execute in our own different spheres of endeavor in the name of Jesus. We pray for the grace to create a niche for ourselves, even in our own businesses, in the name of Jesus. She talked a lot about understanding and wisdom. The Bible says in Proverbs 24, verse 3, that through wisdom a house is built, and by understanding it is established. So, Father, we pray for wisdom, and we pray, Lord, that through good understanding, you will establish that which you've given unto us and that which you've built for us in Jesus' name. So as you've prayed for yourself, I want you to begin to pray for the Networks Business Club. It's a good thing they've started. They've been consistently bringing us this session every month. Let us pray for more grace and wisdom even upon the members of the group, that the Lord will continue to strengthen this group and they will continue to shine as lights and occupy for our Lord Jesus Christ and make a difference. In Jesus' name. And let us pray for our pastors, Pastor ID and Pastor Shiju Williamade, and for giving us this opportunity to have such a platform, that the Almighty God will continue to strengthen them. He's giving them a vision of exceeding greatness, that the Lord will continue to enable them, that the Lord will keep the vision alive. And as we continue to work with them, we will continue to run with that vision of exceeding greatness. It's still the year of great momentum. It's still the year of restoration and recovery. Let us pray for ourselves that in spite of what has happened pre-COVID, post-COVID, during COVID, and even now, that the Lord, we will still have that momentum. And everything that we have lost, we'll recover all in the name of Jesus. Father, we just want to thank you for a time of refreshing in your presence. Let your name be glorified. Even as we step out of here, we step out even to shine as light in our own in our nation and even beyond the borders of Nigeria, in Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Father, for this wonderful session. In Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, Ma. Thank you so much. Thank you to everyone. Yes, thank you so much, Ma. So we have come to another, I won't use the word Ed, another highlight period of this particular event today. We want to say thank you to all our participants. We want to say thank you for coming. We are grateful. Without you, we will not be holding this and hosting this every month. We've had a series of events this year, and trust me, we still have more in store for you. Beyond just this session itself, there are so many other things that are already on the cards for you. So stick with us, stay with us, and we thank you to. We say thank you to all our first timers once again. Please know that another month, next month, watch out for our emails. Go to our social media pages. Go there and check more. You will see our past events, and you will also be notified of the coming ones as well. Go to Networks Business Club on all social platforms at Networks Business Club. Also check RCCG City of David as well, and you'll be able to get this. We see you, Gift Modi, on the Facebook page. We say thank you. Leslie Gil Aga, we say thank you to everyone who has joined us all, from all over the world. Benjamin Olorunfemi, you've been here. We say thank you to you as well. A lot of people, Ade Deji, Bimsola Comfort, Ade Jumoke Gabriel, Ade Ronke Ajiba B, you know, wonderful people from all over the world. And to all my colleagues as well, who are even behind the scenes, you know, a lot of people come together to make this happen. We cannot just, it's a team effort, and we say thank you to everyone. We say thank you to all members of the Networks Business Club as well. You've been fantastic, and we can only say thank you. Please watch out, like I said, go and wish FBO, check for her, Funke Brockner Obrute. You'll see her online. Wish her a happy birthday. Thank her for us, because this has been free. Like Margaret Adesanya said, this has been free. It's you know, it's been done free, and we will definitely share more information of how you can join the Networks Business Club itself. If you join, there'll be more goodies for you. So we would want you to watch out for this. We'll send out membership instructions and details, just a token amount that you can use to support this program every year. It's an annual membership. And once you join, just indicate interest and we'll be able to send this to you as well. The administrators will reach out to you and you'll be able to get more information. At this junction, we can only say thank you, and we give you a wonderful, wonderful, we hope you have a wonderful time ahead. Thank you. God bless. My name remains Olusegun Oyetunji, and everybody stay blessed. Thank you.